Behind the smooth running machine of the classic Motown record label were the groovy and enchanting sounds of musicians and audio engineers who often go unseen and uncredited, even today. We're going to hear all about these musicians and audio engineers as we take a tour of the most hallowed ground in music history.
Hi, my name is Ian McGill. Thank you for joining me in the world-famous Studio A, also known as the Snake Pit. From the cords hanging from the ceiling, being below level, that allowed performers to move around more freely. In this room, from 59 to 72, most of the Motown songs you know and love were recorded. On this piano, artists like Stevie Wonder honed their craft. These keys were last touched by Marvin Gaye during the famous What's Going On production. This room holds so many powerful and legendary musical moments. Not bad for a room that started off as a garage. Where I'm standing now was where that garage ended. Berry Gordy's father, who was in construction, extended it out into the alley, added insulation to the ceiling, soundboards to the wall, and an unvarnished wooden floor so that there would be a distinctive sound.
It was a sound so distinctive, so catchy, that only a certain group of talent with a certain style could pull it off. The technicians' contributions equally added to that distinct sound. Kenneth Sands served as an audio engineer in the late 60s and early 70s. He remembers that time as if it were yesterday.
I spent a lot of times in that green chair behind that beat up old console looking through that window out in the studio. And when I was back there and sitting in that chair and looking out through the window again recently, I expected to see Eddie Bongo on the right. I expected to see Earl Van Dyke at the piano and
James Jamison
and Eddie Willis, Chank, Robert White and Pistol. And Earl Jones doing, you know, Don't Let the Joneses Get You Down, or Psychedelic Shack, some of the things I did. And I miss the guys. They're such a talented group of musicians. In those days, the Motown days, you had to have a lot of talented people to make a record. Not just the rhythm players, the Funk Brothers, but you had the Detroit Symphony Orchestra strings, and Johnny Trudell and his men on horns, and you know, songwriters that were living here, producers that were living here. Stevie lived here, Gladys used to live here, the Four Tops, Temptations, just all these people were living in Detroit, creating music, and it was just, it was a heady kind of thing going on. You could feel the power when you went into the studio.
All of that talent behind the scenes could only be overshadowed by the bigger-than-life musical groups and singers that made Motown fab.
You've been alone, but for long.
baritone player over there, that low B flat you have down there, can you bring it out just a little bit more?
And Benny, watch the tempo.
I started Motown in 1967, and I was just a young kid. I was about 20 years old, and I had always loved records, recording, audio, and to work at Motown was like, wow, it's a dream come true.
You can imagine the Supremes performing, the Four Tops, the Spinners, the Temptations, all practicing their moves right here. This is Motown. Imagine with me, if you will, this room in its heyday. When it was going 24/7, whether it was 3 o'clock in the morning or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, there were musicians, performers, engineers, all here. Come back with me. Imagine when the door was closed, the air conditioning off to eliminate ambient sound, the music blasting, musicians smoking, laughing, mixing all those ingredients, creating without even their awareness a musical legacy that would be known in Detroit, in Des Moines, in Des Nang. The legendary sound of Motown.
The legend was not just created by all of the talented artists mentioned earlier, but guys like Howard Richard Allen, better known as Pistol, played on the Supremes' Baby Love and Martha and the Vandellas' Heat Wave. It is also his dynamic drumming heard on Marvin Gaye's How Sweet It Is. Another member of the Funk Brothers was Johnny Griffith, classically trained keyboard player. You can hear him on hits such as The Shy Lights' Have You Seen Her? And Jackie Wilson's Higher and Higher. The talented list of musicians that comprise the Funk Brothers goes on and on. Earl Van Dyke and Joe Hunter, keyboardists. Eddie Willis, Joe Messina, and Robert White, guitarists. A&R director, producer, and arranger Hank Cosby helped to make hits such as My Sharia Moore and Smokey Robinson's Tears of a Clown. He was respected by artists for his talent so much that Stevie Wonder played My Sharia Moore at his funeral in Detroit.
The famous studio musicians, the Funk Brothers, had more number one hits than the Beatles and the Beach Boys combined. Their heart was a piano player by the name of Earl Van Dyke, who played this piano right here. This is a room rich with history. If you listen carefully, you can almost hear the tch, tch from when famous studio musician Pistol Allen played these drums. Jack Ashford, who played these vibraphones. Eddie Bongo played right there. And Dean Taylor, who often played the tambourines for famous songwriters like Holland Dozier, Holland, would perform right there.
world is empty without you, babe.
This amp here was used to help create the Motown sound. Eddie Willis would plug in here. Robert White would plug in right here. The clavinet, sometimes Stevie Wonder himself, would plug in right here. And we can't forget the bass of James Jamison right here. This organ, a Hammond B3, could be heard on many Motown albums. It, along with the Leslie speaker, was perhaps most well known for being played by Lamont Dozier. These rooms to my left and right are the overdub room. In these rooms, the horns and the strings would perform. In this room, the harpsichord, the double manual harpsichord that you may remember from such pieces as The Supremes, Love Is Here and Now You're Gone. These rooms were instrumental, no pun intended, for the creation of the Motown sound. In this room, incidental instruments would be played. Blocks, cowbell, whatever. This is the isolation room. From this window, the horn section could watch the artist perform without worrying that their sound might overwhelm that which was going on in there. During studio sessions, musicians would wear headphones like this one so that they could hear what they themselves and the other performers were doing. They could make sure that they were weaving a tapestry together.
Guitars, I wish y'all, you know, give a little better feeling on that, those guitar figures.
And also the piano could add a little more emphasis on the bass part there. Okay, then let's take it from letter C. And same place, letter C there.
All right, here we go, letter C. Straight into the chorus after letter C. One time through, take the second ending. One, two, one, two.
Friendships, hits, and memories made right here in one room, Studio A.
Okay, stand by. You ready?
Stand by. Roll.
Nothing you could say could tear me away from my guy. You know, the sound of Motown has meant so much to Detroit and the world. The hits, seemingly limitless, the performers, truly gifted. And everyone, from the musicians to the audio engineers to the truck drivers who delivered the records, worked together to make Motown truly fab. Berry Gordy's dream team assembled right here in Detroit. Rock on, Motown. Rock on. Nothing you could say could tear me away from